everybody, and welcome to 700 Club Interactive. We want to hear from you today. You can Skype in, you can call us, or chat online by going to cbn.com, but we welcome your participation.
First, we want to introduce you to Mike Barrett. For this surfer, the bigger the risk, the better the ride. That same risk-taking took him to the end of his marriage until something pulled him back.
I believe that there's a whole world of people like me who love the edge, and they love to push everything a little bit too far.
Mike Barrett loves extreme sports, but his addiction to adrenaline has been the cause for much of his turmoil.
All your friends smoke pot, all your friends surf, all your friends skateboard, so you skateboard, surf, and smoke pot. It's just expected. I had gone to Judson College in Illinois, and as a Southern California surfer guy, that was very difficult for me, so I hated every minute of it.
That all changed when Mike stumbled into a campus Bible study.
As I walked into that room, I felt the Lord's presence come on me and had no more desire for drugs and alcohol and that kind of party life.
Mike met Lisa, who was also a Christian,
and finished college and got married, and life started again for me.
Mike and Lisa became the parents of two sons, but this joy was soon overshadowed when Lisa received devastating news.
She had a bump on her neck, and she went and had it checked out, and it was the conversation that nobody wants to hear. They tell you that she has cancer.
Lisa received treatment, but it was too late. The disease spread all over her body. She was only 31 years old when she lost her battle with cancer.
She had a 5-year-old and a 2-year-old. It was horrible. I just wouldn't wish that on anybody. I was pretty mad, and I felt like I was getting a raw deal, where I began to live a little bit more recklessly. I did the three things that they tell you never to do if your spouse dies. They say, don't change your job, don't move from your house, and don't get married. And I did all three of those things within the first 10 months of losing my wife.
It was only 8 months after Lisa's passing that Mike was introduced to Donna.
And we went out every night almost for the next 2 months, and then I asked her to marry me, and we were married a week later.
We talked about Lisa, and honestly, it was not difficult to talk about her. I never felt threatened by her.
She encouraged me to talk about Lisa. She put up pictures of Lisa by the kid's bed. She would pray with the kids at night about their mother. She was pretty amazing.
Even though Donna became a part of the family, Mike's feelings of grief finally caught up with him.
I hadn't appropriately grieved the loss of my wife. I was very unhappy in my marriage. I was very unhappy in my job. I was difficult to be around, I think, for everybody.
It wasn't long before Donna found emails Mike had written to an old girlfriend.
I just remember Josh was on the floor drawing. And just thinking about him and, you know, what would happen if Mike and I didn't make it. And, you know, he'd already lost his mom, and, you know, can't lose somebody else. Can't lose another mom, you know.
He didn't meet his former girlfriend, but he did make plans to meet another woman in Los Angeles.
Those plans were coming together, and it was all secret, and everything was set, you know, just fine. I decided not to get on the airplane at the last minute. I just knew that if I crossed the threshold of that jetway, that I was going into a whole other world. I started a 3-day fast, and during that fast, God really was speaking deeply to me about how fake I am and how my wife was phenomenal for me.
And this breakthrough led to real conversation with Donna.
It was surprising to me because I had expected her to leave me or be extremely hurt, but instead she was relieved.
Finally, you know, he's telling me the truth. And I loved that he was telling me the truth.
What God was really saying to me is he was saying, I love everything about you. I love the deepest part of you. I love that you love the edge. I love that you take risk. In fact, I made you that way for a reason. So that's what was happening to me. It was so much more than just confessing certain things to my wife. It was that God still loved me.
Mike shares this love with surfers and other thrill seekers through his ministry and his book, The Danger Habit.
The way that we're wired, which is to love that danger and love the edge work of life, is a godly thing. And if we are serving the Lord, if we're following him, if we're following his voice, he uses those people in profound ways. It was the awakening of my whole spiritual life and everybody's life when they realized that God still loves them. That's the gospel.
Yeah, God does still love us, and that is the gospel. That is the good news, and it's wonderful news, particularly when you start thinking that you're not lovable for things that you've done, thoughts that you've had, and you start looking in the mirror, you don't even love yourself. And you start wondering, how in the world can God love me? He can't want anything to do with me. But then when you hear the good news that, yes, while we were yet sinners, Christ loved us enough to die for us, pay all that penalty, then we can start that process of reconciliation with him. And through that process, once we're reconciled with him, we can then be reconciled with us. With others. What Mike is talking through, I think a lot of people are experiencing, and I just want to give some, you know, just some tips for those who are either in a troubled marriage or you're considering marriage, and, you know, there's just some basics that you have to get straight. And if you're considering marriage, one of the basics you got to get straight is, are you happy with yourself? And if you're not, then you need to take a giant step back and say, I'm not ready to really give myself. You know, it's a fundamental. If you think marriage is going to change you, well, you're right, but it's not going to change you the way you think or your hope. And if you think getting married to somebody is going to change them or you're going to be able to fix them through marriage, again, take a step back. This isn't the way it should be. Both partners need to be equally prepared. The Bible talks about the great marriage with Jesus, where we get prepared for that marriage, that we get presented to him spotless, and then the marriage celebration occurs. You get fixed first. You get presented. And that is what happens. And he is able to present you in his presence spotless with great joy. So he can work that out for us, but that needs to be worked out prior to marriage. Three great principles for marriage. Number one, make sure you marry a Christian. If you're a Christian, make sure you marry a Christian. Do not be unequally yoked. And I'll add into that on the unequally yoked, make sure you have the same passion for God. You know, if you've got it in your heart that God wants you to be a missionary, be in full-time ministry, and you marry a lukewarm Christian, you're going to have trouble. It's not going to work out the way you think. Your passion is not going to be infectious. If they don't come to the marriage with that, you're going to have problems. Second is, make sure you understand before you get married, what are the expectations? What are the expectations on job, career? What are the expectations about money? Do you think about money the same way? Do you spend money the same way? Do you like having hidden money that is sort of your personal thing? All those issues need to get worked out. Also, what are your expectations on kids? Do both of you want kids? Do you want the same number of kids? Are you willing to sacrifice to have that? For me, I didn't realize how selfish I was until I got married. And then suddenly, whoops, my bank account is not my own anymore. My house is not my own anymore. The things that I want to do, well, I've got to work those out. And those are just a series of negotiations. But then I had children. And boy, did I really find out how selfish I was. And children require continual sacrifice. And there's no end to that. They're with you for your entire lifetime. And you start to really understand that when you're looking at that tiny bundle of joy that, okay, now I'm responsible. And that's the ultimate purpose of marriage, is to have children. And the reason God wants healthy marriages is He wants righteous children. And that is the ultimate goal, is that you form a family unit for the express purpose of raising righteous children. And when you look at it through those eyes, well, then marriage becomes a different transaction. It's a lot more than just romantic love. And if you start understanding that before you get involved in that covenant relationship, then you'll probably have a happier, better marriage. But as anybody who's ever been married will tell you, there's lots of things that come along the way that you're not prepared for, that you're not trained for. And where's, you know, marriage 101? There's no course for it other than you live it. And so if you're like Mike and you've gone through a grieving process and you rush into a remarriage, and then you find yourself in that marriage and suddenly you realize, I'm not happy, I wasn't fixed, I didn't go through my grieving process, there are things I'm trying to act out in my life. If you bring drugs and alcohol into a marriage, you're bringing things that have no business there. If you're bringing other romantic relationships into your marriage, that doesn't have any business there. And if you're not settled that this is the one and only, well, then you need to stop. And I love what Mike did. He got honest with himself. And then he got honest with God. He went on a 3-day fast and suddenly asked God to, all right, shine a light here. And when God started to shine that light on some hidden areas of his heart, it can be disturbing, but it led to incredible healing. If you're in a troubled marriage right now, one of the best things for you to do individually is start looking at your own faults and ask God to reveal them to you. Stop blaming your spouse. Shine that light in your heart. Where are issues that you have problems with? It's very easy to blame your partner. But when you start looking at yourself and saying, what am I doing wrong here? How can I get right with God? Because that's the key. When you get right with God, then you're able to be right with other people. That's the first step. That's the first step, so take it. Second step, you've got to communicate. And you've got to communicate openly and honestly. When Mike finally went to Donna to talk, no more mask, no more pretend, no more hidden areas of your life, no more things you're trying to cover up and hide, but you really get gut honest with your spouse. I love her reaction. Finally, I had the truth. Finally, I had the truth. If you're in trouble in your marriage, try that. Try honesty for a change. First, get right with God. Make sure that you're not bringing any of your resentments and hurts to that conversation. But when you finally get honest and you finally get transparent, well, now you have something that you can build on, because the truth will set you free. Remember that. We're going to be praying for marriages today. If you've got issues, if you're considering marriage and you want some guidance, or if you're in marriage and you're having trouble, we want to pray for you. So we'll be right back right after this.
A cookie from the cookie jar.
You?
Yes, me, and I lost 105 pounds.
Who stole cookies from the cookie jar? I stole the cookies from the cookie jar. Yes, me. And I lost 115 pounds in 6 months.
If you want to lose up to 15 pounds a month, get Smart for Life cookies. Doctors developed Smart for Life cookies with extracts from natural ingredients like fruits, vegetables, wheat, and dairy. Smart cookie meals replace breakfast and lunch so you can save $1,200 a year on food.
Just pop a cookie. It'll save you a fortune over other plans. Eat cookies, lose weight. It's that simple.
Order now and get a free week of cookies plus free UPS delivery. Lose weight, save money. An average of $1,200 a year on food. Get smart. Call 1-800-314-3206. That's 1-800-314-3206.
Day 87, and Tyler B. is still in that aisle, determined to find the answer for his acne.
Kid, get a life. I'm trying.
The truth is, acne, even when it's mild, is a medical condition.
Huh?
Medical as in doctor?
And that's how Tyler came to his senses, sort of, and learned about once-a-day prescription Epiduo Gel. If you're not getting the results you want, ask your doctor about Epiduo, two of the most doctor-prescribed acne-fighting ingredients in one gel medication, a product you can't get in the acne aisle. Dryness, redness, peeling, stinging, burning, or itching may occur. Don't use irritating products when using Epiduo. Overexposure to sun, sun lamps, extreme wind, or cold may increase the risk for irritation. Use of sunscreen and protective clothing is advised. Go to truthaboutzits.com and learn how to pay no more than $20 for your Epiduo prescription.
Awesome.
To learn more about Epiduo Gel, talk to your doctor. Call or go to truthaboutzits.com.
Well, Superbook, a CBN animation series, teaches kids more than just Bible stories. It applies those stories to modern-day situations and helps kids learn valuable life lessons, just like the boy you're about to meet.
Cherie and John Gregory described their 6-year-old son, Joel, as fun and outgoing. So when it was time to sign up for their church's Easter program, they were sure Joel would jump at the chance. There was just one problem.
He has a fear of standing in front of a group of people and performing.
Joel had his own words to describe how he felt.
Frightened, terrified.
Although John and Cherie tried and tried to convince him that it would be fun, Joel would have no part of it.
The other kids practiced for 2 months and I refused.
About that time, Joel and his sister Selah started watching Superbook. Joel loved watching the Superbook characters Chris, Joy, and Gizmo.
We put it in, and he watched it over and over and over, and so did our daughter, Selah. And they watched it probably 50 times that first week, at least.
Pretty soon, he memorized the whole episode word for word. That gave John an idea.
We were watching it one day, and my husband turned to Joel and he said, "Look, Joel, Chris was afraid to perform, but what did David tell him?" And Joel said, "He said that he should do it for God." And my husband said, "That's right. You shouldn't be afraid of performing, because if you're doing it for God, there's nothing to be afraid of."
Then on Easter morning, a child decided to drop out of the program.
The children's pastor walked up to my wife and said, "Joel wants to perform." And then he told us that he wanted to do it for God, and he's not going to be afraid.
My husband and I cried because we knew how much courage that was taking for him to even say that.
After only 10 minutes of practice, Joel performed his part perfectly. Joel says watching Superbook taught him not to be afraid and to trust God.
We just started watching Superbook and Jack just encouraged me.
He went from being terrified and frightened to doing something that was really scary to him, all for the glory of God. You know, these are the kind of truths about God, about his power, about his love and his grace and mercy extended to us that are a part of the teachings in Superbook. And this has opened all kinds of opportunity to us, not just here at home for kids like Joel, but all around the world. In fact, there are many countries that we now have access to because of Superbook and what it's meant. But we're doing it in a whole new style. And Gordon, you can probably address anime better than I can. What is the difference between Superbook as we knew it over the last couple of decades and what you've done
Superbook
now?
Is actually considered one of the first animes ever done. And the director of the original series from Japan that was started in 1981 and finished in 1984 went on to fame as a anime director. This has certain anime styles to it, but a purist would say, well, it's not traditional anime because it's three-dimensional.
So what do you call it? Is there a name
brand new.
For it? it's a new Superbook.
It's Superbook is what I call it. And when the first concepts came back in two dimensions and in the traditional anime style, I actually said no. You know, that's nice, but it's not really the vision that we have for this. We want to make it three-dimensional and really give it that kind of treatment. It costs more money to do it that way, but I think it's worth it. I want a series that can really endure and can captivate a whole generation
and
with the Bible stories.
That's what it's going to be, the Bible from beginning to end. And so we want to invite you to participate with us in the production of this, which will also allow you to participate with us in taking it into the nations of the earth so that children everywhere will be able to understand the power that's in the Word of God. If you'd like to be a part of that, you can give by going to 888-777-1999. Just call us at that number, or you can log on to CBN.com, but Superbook has an amazing potential to make a difference in the nations of the earth. So let's join together and see that happen. That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, this time, the original series dealt mostly with the Old Testament. This time, we're going to start in the Garden of Eden and explain how did Satan get there, and then take it all the way until when Jesus comes back and we're with him, that the God's dream of what he intended for us in the Garden of Eden hasn't died, and he is going to see us through completion. Mm-hmm. We're going to spend three of the initial 13 on the life of Jesus, his birth, his miracles, his death and resurrection. We have one story on the conversion of Paul as he's on the way to Damascus. But that's 13-episode series. This isn't a short-term project for us. It's going to take us 2 years to finish that. Tomorrow we go into the table read for three of the initial episodes we're going to produce. And we need funding to make it happen. We've got the pilot, and so we're asking you to participate in what we're doing. And for your gift of $25 or more, you can help produce the rest of the series, because that $25 is going to go directly into the production of the future of this series. And we're looking for people to really partner with us. Well, I also have something else for you. It's called my.cbn.com, and it's a new social networking site that's part of cbn.com. There's an example of the page, your personal page, that you can set up. You can put in your own photos, information about yourself. You can invite friends to join. And then we've got something as part of this where you can have missions. And the first mission we have is Superbook. So if you want to adopt Superbook as a mission and just say, we can restore biblical literacy to America, we can restore biblical literacy to the world, we can get the gospel out to this generation, if you want to be part of that mission, just do it. My.cbn.com. We're also looking at future missions, and I'm hoping to expand it out so we can have a whole host of causes to help establish the kingdom, to help spread the kingdom around the world. So if you want to be a part of it, go to my.cbn.com, or you can just log on to cbn.com. We'll have a link. There's also a link on the interactive page where you just click on that, and we'll get you right into it. But participate. Be with us. Join with us. Let's create a whole network of people that want to bring Superbook to the world. We're going to take calls for prayer right now. This is Rhonda from California. She's going through problems with her marriage, and her husband's out of work. Rhonda, how can we pray for you?
We have stood and bound and loosed and spoke and everything we've known to do for so long. So how can you pray? Just at this point, agreement that we'll have restoration.
Restoration in your marriage?
A restoration, period. We've moved, and my husband took this job and then lost it, and we don't have really a support system out here. We're in the natural at the end of the line.
Rhonda, where's your family?
In the Midwest.
In the Midwest. All right. Do you have a church you're going to?
We're trying to hook in, but we don't have that all rooted.
Rhonda, the word I'm hearing for you right now is return to your first love. Return to your first love. So let me ask you a question. Where was your first love? Do you even remember?
Well, just with Jesus, spending time in his presence.
Okay. When's the last time you did that?
Today, this morning.
Okay.
But sometimes it's hard to hear him with the stress of everything.
Right. The cares and concerns of this world can really choke out the word and stop you from hearing.
Right.
But I'm picking up geographically where you're in such an unsettled state, and there's just real sense that you and your husband are all alone against the world. Was your first love ministry?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, I'm getting strong. You need to return to your first love. And I'm sorry you got diverted. I'm sorry that you went out to California looking into how can we move into the secular world. And I don't understand. I don't need to understand all the issues that led you out of ministry, but I'm getting pretty strong. Return to your first love. So we're just going to pray for you right now, Rhonda, and we're going to ask God to intervene, and we're going to ask that the friends you knew in ministry will be moved by him to call you. Lord, we just lift Rhonda to you right now, and I ask for the peace of God to come. The gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. Terry, you've got something.
And the picture that I have as I pray for you is of the two of you standing, not looking toward each other, but side by side with your hands joined, prepared to move. I mean, you're not bowed down. God is the lifter of your head. He's lifting you up right now. And even this thing that you've been going through is not for naught. You know, you have the promise that everything that happens to you comes under the authority of the one whom you serve, and that everything that happens to you will be used for righteousness and for good. And so God's going to take even this time that's been so difficult for you and your husband. The day is going to come, and not too far down the road, where you're going to look back and say, that's what God was teaching us. That's what God was deepening in us. But I just would speak to the spirit within you and say, rise up, because your God is moving you forward. And you need to stand in the authority of that with expectancy and anticipation and faith, not with your head bowed down and not filled with anxiety, but believing that God is about to move mountains on your behalf, and he's taking you somewhere you couldn't have gone to if you hadn't made this transition. You didn't miss the call of God on your life. You're exactly where you're supposed to be. You're just afraid because you can't see the future. But God is speaking to you to believe him for all things. I'm not telling you there's a specific job I know about that you're going to get. Only God knows that. I'm just telling you that I see you and your husband linked together with a fresh beginning, walking down a new road in a new direction. And the Lord has gone before you in all of this. So be encouraged.
Rhonda, I got a verse for you. It's from Romans chapter 5. I just sense that God wants to give you new hope. And here's the verse. And hope does not disappoint us. You won't be disappointed, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us.
Amen. Amen.
Amen, Rhonda. Be filled with hope. And just wait for that call.
I've been in the place where you're at. Was there for quite a while, actually. And one of the things that God really taught me in the midst of that place was not to look to my husband for the answers, and for my husband not to look to me for the answers, that my help came from the Lord, and that he was in total control of our circumstances. So be encouraged in that.
It's an honor to talk with you.
It's an honor to pray for you. God bless you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. That's all the time we have for today's program. If you're watching on ABC Family Channel, stay tuned. The 700 Club is coming up next. We leave you with these words from Jeremiah 33:3. Call to me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you do not know. God bless you.